Hi, I'm Carrie-Anne and welcome to Crash Course Computer Science. Last episode we talked about data storage, how technologies like magnetic tape and hard disks can store trillions of bits of data for long durations, even without power, which is perfect for recording big blobs of related data, what are more commonly called computer files. You've no doubt encountered many types, like text files, music files, photos and videos. Today we're going to talk about how files work and how computers keep them all organised with file systems. It's perfectly legal for a file to contain arbitrary unformatted data, but it's most useful and practical if the data inside the file is organized somehow. This is called a file format. You can invent your own, and programmers do that from time to time, but it's usually best and easiest to use an existing standard, like JPEG and MP3. Let's look at some simple file formats. The most straightforward are text files, also known as TXT files, which contain, surprise, text. Like all computer files, this is just a huge list of numbers stored as binary. If we look at the raw values of a text file in storage, it would look something like this. We can view this as decimal numbers instead of binary, but that still doesn't help us read the text. The key to interpreting this data is knowing that text files use ASCII, a character encoding standard we discussed way back in episode 4. So in ASCII, our first value 72 maps to the capital letter H, and in this way we decode the whole file. Let's look at a more complicated example, a WAV file, also called a WAV, which stores audio. Before we can correctly read the data, we need to know some information, like the bit rate and whether it's a single track or stereo. Data about data is called metadata. This metadata is stored at the front of the file ahead of any actual data, in what's known as a header. Here's what the first 44 bytes of a WAV file looks like. Some parts are always the same, like where it spells out WAVE. Other parts contain numbers that change depending on the data contained within. The audio data comes right behind the metadata, and it's stored as a long list of numbers. These values represent the amplitude of sound captured many times per second. And if you want a primer on sound, check out our video all about it in Crash Course Physics, link in the doobly-doo. As an example, let's look at a waveform of me saying hello. Hello! Now that we've captured some sound, let's zoom into a little snippet. A digital microphone, like the one in your computer or smartphone, samples the sound pressure thousands of times. Each sample can be represented as a number. Larger numbers mean higher sound pressure, what's called amplitude. And these numbers are exactly what gets stored in a WAV file, thousands of amplitudes for every single second of audio. When it's time to play this file, an audio program needs to actuate the computer's speakers, such that the original waveform is emitted. Hello! So now that you're getting the hang of file format, let's talk about bitmaps or BMPs, which store pictures. On a computer, pictures are made up of tiny square elements called pixels. Each pixel is a combination of three colours, red, green and blue. These are called additive primary colours and they can be mixed together to create any other colour on our electronic displays. Now just like WAV files, bitmaps start with metadata, including key values like image width, image height and colour depth. As an example, let's say the metadata specified an image 4 pixels wide by 4 pixels tall, with a 24-bit colour depth. That's 8 bits for red, 8 bits for green, and 8 bits for blue. As a reminder, 8 bits is the same as 1 byte. The smallest number a byte can store is 0, and the largest is 255. Our image data is going to look something like this. Let's look at the colour of our first pixel. It has 255 for its red value, 255 for green, and 255 for blue. This equates to full intensity red, full intensity green, and full intensity blue. These colours blend together on your computer monitor to become white, so our first pixel is white. The next pixel has a red, green, blue, or RGB value of 255, 255, 0. That's the colour yellow. The pixel after that has an RGB value of 0, 0, 0. That's zero intensity everything, which is black. And the next one is yellow. Because the metadata specified this was a 4x4 image, we know that we've reached the end of our first row of pixels. So we need to drop down a row. The next RGB value is 255, 255, 0, yellow again. Okay, let's go ahead and read all the pixels in our 4x4 image. Ta-da! A very low resolution Pac-Man. Obviously, this is a simple example of a small image, but we could just as easily store this image in a bitmap. I want to emphasize again that it doesn't matter if it's a text file, WAV, bitmap, or fancier formats we don't have time to discuss. Under the hood, they're all the same. Long lists of numbers stored as binary on a storage device. File formats are the key to reading and understanding the data inside. Now that you understand files a little better, let's move on to how computers go about storing them. Even though the underlying storage medium might be a strip of tape, a drum, a disk, or integrated circuits, hardware and software abstractions let us think of storage as a long line of little buckets that store values. In the early days, when computers only performed one computation, like calculating artillery range tables, the entire storage operated like one big file. Data started at the beginning of storage and then filled it up in order as output was produced, up to the storage capacity. However, as computational power and storage capacity improved, it became possible and useful to store more than one file at a time. The simplest option is to store files back to back. This can work, but how does the computer know where files begin and end? Storage devices have no notion of files, they're just a mechanism for storing lots of bits. So for this to work, we need to have a special file that records where other ones are located. This goes by many names, but a good general term is directory file. Most often it's kept right at the front of storage, so we always know where to access it. Location 0. Inside the directory file are the names of all the other files in storage. In our example, they each have a name, followed by a period, and end with what's called a file extension, like BMP or WAV. Those further assist programs in identifying file types. The directory file also stores metadata about these files, like when they were created and last modified, who the owner is, and if they can be read, written, or both. But most importantly, the directory file contains where these files begin in storage and how long they are. If we want to add a file, remove a file, change a file name, or similar, we have to update the information in the directory file. It's like the table of contents in a book. If you make a chapter shorter or move it somewhere else, you have to update the table of contents, otherwise the page numbers won't match. The directory file and the maintenance of it is an example of a very basic file system, the part of an operating system that manages and keeps track of stored files. This particular example is called a flat file system because they're all stored at one level. It's flat. Of course, packing files together back to back is a bit of a problem, because if we want to add some data to, let's say, to-do.txt, there's no room to do it without overwriting part of carry.bitmap. So modern file systems do two things. First, they store files in blocks. This leaves a little extra space for changes, called slack space. It also means that all file data is aligned to a common size, which simplifies management. In a scheme like this, our directory file needs to keep track of what block each one is stored in. The second thing file systems do is allow files to be broken up into chunks and stored across many blocks. So let's say we open to-do.txt and we add a few more items. Then the file becomes too big to be saved in its one block. We don't want to overwrite the neighbouring one, so instead the file system allocates an unused block, which can accommodate extra data. With a file system scheme like this, the directory file needs to store not just one block per file, but rather a list of blocks per file. In this way, we can have files of variable sizes that can be easily expanded and shrunk, simply by allocating and deallocating blocks. If you watched our episode on operating systems, this should sound a lot like virtual memory. Conceptually, it's very similar. Now let's say we want to delete carry.bitmap. To do that, we can simply remove the entry from the directory file. This, in turn, causes one block to become free. Note that we didn't actually erase the file's data in storage, we just deleted the record of it. At some point, that block will be overwritten with new data, but until then, it just sits there. This is one way that computer forensic teams can recover data from computers, even though people think it's been deleted. Crafty. Okay, let's say we add even more items to our to-do list, which causes the file system to allocate yet another block to the file, in this case, recycling the block freed from carry.bitmap. Now our to-do.txt is stored across three blocks spaced apart and also out of order. Files getting broken up across storage like this is called fragmentation. It's the inevitable byproduct of files being created, deleted, and modified. For many storage technologies, this is bad news. On magnetic tape, reading to-do.txt into memory would require seeking to block 1, then fast-forwarding to block 5, and then rewinding to block 3. That's a lot of back and forth. In real-world file systems, large files might be stored across hundreds of blocks, and you don't want to have to wait 5 minutes for your files to open. The answer is defragmentation. That might sound like technobabble, but the process is really simple, and once upon a time, it was really fun to watch. The computer copies around data so that files have blocks located together in storage and in the right order. After we've defragged, we can read our to-do file, now located in blocks 1 through 3 in a single quick read pass. So far, we've only been talking about flat file systems, where they're all stored in one directory. This worked okay when computers only had a little bit of storage, and you might only have a dozen or so files, but as storage capacity exploded, like we discussed last episode, so did the number of files on computers. Very quickly, it became impractical to store all files together at one level. Just like documents in the real world, it's handy to store related files together in folders. Then we can put connected folders into folders and so on. This is a hierarchical file system, and it's what your computer uses. There are a variety of ways to implement this, but let's stick with the file system example we've been using to convey the main idea. The biggest change is that our directory file needs to be able to point not just to files, but also other directories. To keep track of what's a file and what's a directory, we need some extra metadata. This directory file is the topmost one, known as the root directory. All other files and folders lie beneath this directory, along various file paths. We can see inside of our root directory file that we have three files and two subdirectories, music and photos. If we want to see what's stored in our music directory, we have to go to that block and read the directory file located there. The format is the same as our root directory. There's a lot of great songs in there. In addition to being able to create hierarchies of unlimited depth, this method also allows us to easily move around files. So if we wanted to move theme.wav from our root directory to the music directory, we didn't have to rearrange any blocks of data. We can simply modify the two directory files, removing an entry from one and adding it to another. Importantly, the theme.wav file stays in block 5. So that's a quick overview of the key principles of file systems. They provide yet another way to move up a new level of abstraction. File systems allow us to hide the raw bits stored on magnetic tape, spinning disks and the like, and they let us think of data as neatly organized and easily accessible files. We even started talking about users, not programmers, manipulating data, like opening files and organizing them, foreshadowing where the series will be going in a few episodes. I'll see you next week. Crash Course Computer Science is produced in association with PBS Digital Studios. At their channel, you can check out a playlist of shows like Physics Girl, Deep Look, and PBS Spacetime. This episode was filmed at the Chad and Stacey Emigault studio in Indianapolis, Indiana, and it was made with the help of all these nice people and our wonderful graphics team, Thought Cafe. That's where we're going to have to halt and catch fire. See you next week.